Hey guys, this week's Tech News Day is sponsored by Calm and by Boosted Boards. We'll get to it.
Yeah. Last week, some very disturbing, dystopian, devilish news started making the rounds about some new scientific research suggesting that our cell phones are making us grow horns out of our dang heads.
Awesome.
I mean, hell yeah.
Yeah.
That's the kind of cool sci-fi, heavy metal shit that I've been looking forward to my whole life.
Mm-hmm.
Up till now, it's just been a bunch of bullshit, but horns? This is great.
I'll finally start making more phone calls.
Yeah.
Putting off calling my parents for so long, and then finally, when I realized I could grow horns from doing it, why not?
Yeah. Technology evolving us into a newer, cooler-looking race of humans. It's great. It's going to suck having to cut holes into all my hats to make room for my sweet set of horns, but other than that, I, for one, welcome our new cell phone horns.
Well, if you're a real entrepreneur, you would make hats with horn holes in them.
Get on it now.
Yeah.
A lot of money to be made.
More free advice from us.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay, hold on. Let's not get ahead of ourselves, though. What is this research and what does this research actually say? The news comes from multiple studies written by two researchers at Australia's University of the Sunshine Coast. And first things first, we're not talking about devil horns here. But it's actually a small horn-like bone growth in the back of people's heads known as an enlarged external occipital protuberance.
That doesn't sound quite as cool.
Yeah. We'll figure out a cool name for it.
Occipital protuberance.
It's like how they name animals all those Latin terms, and then we find a cool term.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's much better. It's basically a bone spur. So, hey, no Iran war for us. Can't do it.
Sorry, recruiter. I got a bone spur in the back of my head.
Use the phone too much.
Yeah.
Right off the bat, it's not nearly as cool as it sounded initially when we were talking about horns, but, you know, technically it's still a horn.
No, it's not, because horns are made out of keratin.
But
this is bone.
I'm calling it what I want, a horn.
It's true, you can. That's your right.
Yeah.
Anyways, this type of thing is usually only seen in x-rays of old people who've had terrible posture for decades. What the study says, though, is that it's becoming way more common among younger people. 40% of 18 to 30-year-olds have the horn. Now, what could possibly be causing these otherwise young, healthy people to have the bones of someone several decades older than them? Well, it's those damn phones. You always on that phone, looking down, bending that neck. Or at least that's the hypothesis that the study's authors have come up with. And hey, they might be onto something here, but as often happens when medical literature makes its way into mainstream news, that hypothesis is now being presented as fact because headlines about cell phones causing horns to grow out of your kid's head, they get clicks, baby.
And it's gonna be great. Human evolution will eventually put a horn big enough to have just a little kickstand for your head at
Ooh.
Night when you wanna,
yeah.
You just have a little thing on your bed that has a little, it's a part that sticks out. You just kick your kickstand out.
And then
you
can hang myself up on the coat rack.
Yeah.
And
read all you want.
Yeah.
And that's why old people
stretch
have it.
Myself out.
Old people, they just, if you know, they read either romance novels or war novels in bed all night, and that's how you get it.
Yeah, with their little sleep hats. I don't know why they need a hat to sleep.
But that's why now we're getting it, because we all look at Reddit on our phones before we go to sleep.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking at.
Mm-hmm.
Reddit.
They have porn on Reddit. There's actually plenty of reasons to doubt these conclusions, though, or at least make you less concerned that you've got a horn growing out of the back of your head. And for one thing, that 40% figure makes a little more sense when you take into account that all of the study subjects were people in enough pain to already be visiting a chiropractor. Now, the studies, they also don't bother factoring in each subject's level of phone use. And as many of these experts, they've pointed out, a tiny bone spur in the back of your head should be the least of your posture concerns. Much more serious are things like arthritis or disc degeneration or just the general muscle strain that comes from constantly leaning forward and looking down. I had terrible neck pain for weeks before I finally went and saw a chiropractor. And listen, I thought they were quacks too.
They are.
It fixed it. And I don't care. Pseudoscience works for me.
All right, now just come back next week.
No, I went
every
twice.
Week for the rest of your
and
life.
And I was done.
A few of them are good.
Yeah.
Just be very careful.
Mm-hmm.
But hey, those kinds of problems, they're a little more abstract for some people. It can be the kind of thing that you only really start worrying about once it's already happening to you, at which point you might be too late.
That's every medical problem.
Or you're at least in a position where it's like, fuck, what do I do now?
Yeah.
If the idea of a horn growing out of the back of your head is horrifying enough to get you to sit up straight, then whatever, good. Let the fear motivate you.
Yes.
People are really good at letting totally unlikely things dictate their behavior for the better. So we say, live each day as if a horn's gonna grow out the back of your head if you look down at your phone for too long. Where's the harm?
Worst case scenario, you don't grow one.
Yeah.
But then you're...
Worst case scenario, you have amazing posture.
But then you're going to be devolved from the future humans yeah. that walk the earth.
Hey, roundhead.
Hey, normie.
Where's your horn?
Yeah. all the Chads will have the biggest horns.
Yeah.
Yeah. Moving on to some Facebook news, though. Obviously, Facebook news, never good.
Never.
Casey Newton of The Verge published a new article this week following up on a story that he did back in February that we obviously talked about, and this focused on Facebook's content moderation team in Arizona. To recap, it's hell.
It's
hell
bad.
On earth. You don't want to be involved.
Yeah.
And it's all contract work, so mm-hmm. it's not like you're working for Facebook. Anyways, a lot of people, they seem to be having a pretty bad time just looking at graphic violence and hate content all day. While also worrying about hitting their quotas of reporting it. And they also felt that resources available for their mental health was insufficient, given how traumatizing the job was.
You don't say.
Yeah, it was a big fucking expose, and people should have paid attention to it.
Yeah.
They didn't.
I loved all the comments being like, well, just get a new job. Oh, let me just get a new job.
I'm gonna go down to the job factory yeah. and pick up a new job that pays as much as this does.
Yeah, yeah. A new job that'll traumatize me in some new way. Mm. New and exciting. Now, to be clear, these moderation facilities are not run directly by Facebook.
Exactly.
But rather by a company called Cognizant, who contracts with Facebook. Facebook actually handling the stuff themselves, that would cost a lot of money. And, well, they're not going to do that. They're just contracting that shit out.
Yeah, it potentially costs them a lot in medical expenses for yeah. dealing with all of the people that are suffering PTSD from
if
this.
If these were Facebook employees, they'd have to take some level of responsibility over them.
Exactly.
And they can't do that.
It's responsibility laundering.
Yeah, it's what it is.
Yeah.
Anyway, in his new article, Casey Newton focused on a Cognizant office in Tampa that he says he received a lot of messages about and from after publishing his article on the Phoenix location. And at this point, none of this is at all surprising, but it's still worth briefly summarizing the various ways that working at a place like this totally sucks.
Okay, so first off, a 42-year-old content moderator who coworkers said was stressed out about hitting his quotas had a fucking heart attack and died at work. Like, in the office.
Yeah.
Collapsed. And the management after that, they barely even acknowledged because they didn't want it to get in the way of productivity. Also...
Yeah, he died, but like, worry about yourself.
In the wake of that, in the reporting, they're talking about like one... specifically religious person speaking at tongues
yeah, like
in the prayer office.
Having a complete mental breakdown.
Just like, whoa.
We all cope in different ways, but I'm sure that wasn't great
Sir,
for the...
you can't bring your snakes into the Cognizant office. We appreciate everyone's religious yeah. belief, but please keep the snakes away. But yeah, some guy had a fucking mental breakdown during all of it.
Yeah.
Apparently his fucking dad came to get all of his stuff.
Yeah,
was like, my son died here.
Yeah, the company kept
everyone.
Being like, he's fine. He gave the thumbs up, but he was like literally probably dead before he...
They like folded his thumb up.
Yeah. They're like, yeah, everybody's fine. And then the guy's dad showed up. He's like, yeah, my son died here last night.
And everyone's like, oh, God. They told us everything was fine.
All right, get out of here, old man.
Anyway, so that's a big yikes. Another former moderator, Sean Spiegel, spoke on the record about how he got recruited by Cognizant at a job fair where they basically just flat out lied to him about what the job would be. They told him that he'd be helping big brands analyze their Facebook page engagement. Wow. The first rung on the ladder of success.
Woo.
Working my way up that corporate ladder to where I can be maybe a marketing manager for one of these companies.
It's finally happening.
Instead, 2 weeks after Spiegel was put on the production floor, a manager told him he and a colleague would be reviewing graphic violence and hate speech full time.
Congrats, buddy.
Womp.
Yeah, full time. Now, that's a pretty terrible bait and switch, but it's especially bad when, like Sean Spiegel, you might already have a history of depression and anxiety and would have never agreed to that kind of job in the first place if you knew what you were getting into. Spiegel is also an animal lover who previously volunteered at animal shelters, so it's no surprise that he says he was seriously traumatized by the very first video that he saw on the job. A group of teenagers smashing an iguana to death as it screamed for its life.
Oh, you like animals? Well, you'll be really good at identifying the fact that someone crushing a cat under their heels is probably bad yeah. for the platform.
Yeah.
Great. We're glad to have you on.
But hey, at least he was able to, like, get that content off Facebook, right? Like, do his job, do some justice? No. He says that he had to review that same video several more times, each time automatically being forced to watch at least 15 seconds, because otherwise, how are you supposed to know? And then, because the teens in the video were speaking Spanish, all he could actually do was to flag it to be sent to the Spanish moderation team, wherever they may be, so that one of them would be forced to watch it and be traumatized by it.
Adios mio. Another former employee named Marcus says he was persuaded to leave a more normal job with promises of a better schedule and performance bonuses, but that once he got hired, he was assigned to the night shift and no bonuses ever materialized.
Looks like they flat out lied.
He was hired as a manager, but, quote, Marcus was made to moderate Facebook content, an additional responsibility he says he was not prepared for. A military veteran, he had become desensitized to seeing violence against people, he told me. But on his second day of moderation duty, he had to watch a video of a man slaughtering puppies with a baseball bat. Marcus went home on his lunch break, held his dog in his arms, and cried. I should quit, he thought to himself, but I know there are people at that site that need me. He ultimately stayed for a little over a year. Hug your pets, everyone.
Jesus. Other employees say that, like the Phoenix office, lots of Tampa employees are just high all day long to numb their senses.
And why shouldn't they be?
They say that staff turnaround is a big problem, with people either being fired or quitting, so the hiring standards are really low.
They're already at job fairs.
At one point, a guy got hired who, if they had just done a background check, they would have known that he previously spent 18 months in prison for an investment fraud scheme involving Facebook stock. Incredible.
Billy McFarland. Back at it again.
I'm going to moderate the shit out of this concept. Additionally, it sounds like there's lots of joking in the office about shooting up the place.
Yeah.
Doesn't get properly addressed through the right channels. And multiple employees say that they have a legitimate fear of a mass shooting happening there.
That was in the last article where the guy was like, I brought a gun to work because someone's going to go fucking postal here.
Yeah.
And I want to protect myself.
I'm going to be the good guy with the gun.
Yeah.
I'm also, my mental health is rapidly deteriorating. Yeah, but I plan to be the good guy.
I imagine these Cognizant offices literally like a Wild West saloon, where you walk in and the Cognizant people are like, all right, check your guns at the door.
Yeah.
You can get them when you leave. Everyone have a good time.
Anyway, this is in addition to allegations of verbal and physical fights at the office, as well as theft and sexual harassment. All the markings of a fun workplace.
A Chuck E. Cheese for adults.
Yeah.
Yeah, just a fun place to be. And by the way, this place sounds filthy. It's a 24/7 office, so desks are shared between different employees on different shifts. They take down all your family pictures. Put up their own. Yeah. Some contractors say they show up to find their desk covered in boogers, covered in fingernails, and pubes every once in a while, I'm sure. There's also only one set of bathrooms, which some contractors said they were in a constant state of disrepair, with shit and period blood smeared all over the place. Meanwhile, employees' bathroom time, it was strictly monitored, so in some cases, the site's human resource staff has followed workers who filed complaints to the bathroom and questioned them about what they were doing for the few minutes they were inside.
Oh, sounds great. So, was it a number one or a number two?
It's always number one here at Cognizant.
Jesus.
Our food at the lunchroom is so bad, you'll be taking a number one out of your number two.
I didn't even put this in there, but there was like, there's, because this is more like a Florida law thing, but I didn't know this. Florida doesn't have mandatory sick leave, so like they have to use their personal days. So like people are terrified of taking sick days off. So they come into work just completely ill. And like one woman was like, I had already used up all my bathroom time by like halfway through the day. So I was like, what do I do? So my boss just brought me a bucket.
Oh,
like,
cool.
Here.
Yeah, my mom
almost
couldn't come to my wife's bridal shower because she would have to use her sick days.
Yeah.
And I told my mom how important it was that she be there. So she was like, all right, well, I only get like 4 or 5 sick days a year, but you know, this is worth it. And I was like, we live in hell.
Low taxes, right?
Yeah. But also, they had like when they had a photojournalist go through and take pictures.
Oh, they cleaned the place up.
They put up like signs everywhere.
And that's another thing. Like, they do that same thing when Facebook goes through. So there is actually like a reasonable, it's reasonable to think like even Facebook doesn't know how fucking bad this place is.
Oh, yeah,
because
yeah.
Again, when you outsource it, it's like out of sight, out of mind. You show up like once on a scheduled visit. You're like, yep, everything looks great. And that's the extent of me having to worry about this.
Yeah. We went through this at Machinima where they...
Oh, yeah.
We had the Business Insider people come through, and we had to, like, make it look like it was fucking Chuck E. Cheese and stuff.
Yeah, we're a fun office. Look at all these Nerf guns.
We'll talk about it in the podcast.
Anyways, yeah, it sounds like a really shitty place to work, which is weird, considering that the company they're doing all this work for is one of the biggest tech companies on Earth with a lot of money. And,
yeah.
You know, seems like Facebook could probably afford to make life more comfortable for the people that they're trusting to keep their website clean. But at this point, it's absolutely no surprise that they don't.
Nor should it be. Anyways, in other Facebook news, last week we talked about their upcoming cryptocurrency, Libra, which they envision as a way to financially empower the developing world and finally bring cryptocurrency into the mainstream as actual money that you can spend out in the real world. And like we said last week, it's not the worst idea in the world, but having Facebook attached means it could be dead in the water given how terrible the reputation is with regards to data privacy. And sure enough, Libra, not off to a good start at all.
Oh, darn.
Basically, as soon as the news broke, lawmakers here and in the EU said, sorry, you fucking what? And that's with multiple members of Congress and Parliament giving responses ranging from skepticism to outright saying it shouldn't be allowed to happen, which is pretty much what you'd expect from them in response to Facebook and a bunch of other multinational companies announcing a plan to literally reinvent money.
Sorry, you're...
Wait, hold on.
And you're gonna launch this in like 6 months.
But the euro is.
Again, though, it's pretty clear that for Facebook and their partners in Libra, the real target isn't the U.S. or the EU, but rather countries who have volatile currency and/or shitty banking infrastructure and/or lots of people needing to send money internationally. But it turns out, despite Facebook's biggest user base being in India, they will not be launching Libra there anytime soon because cryptocurrency is basically illegal there. So you can scratch those 1.3 billion people off the list of potential Libra users, along with the 1.3 billion people in China, where Facebook, they don't really operate, as well as all the countries that the U.S. has sanctions against, like Cuba, Iran, Syria, North Korea, Sudan, and of course, Myanmar, which is a country that's had more than enough, you know, Facebook help.
They love
already.
They love Facebook over
Mark,
Myanmar.
You have done enough.
Yeah. Can't wait for the town of Zuckerberg to fully embrace the Libra currency.
He caused a genocide.
He did. He caused a big old genocide. Now, meanwhile, Facebook co-founder and original spokesman Chris Hughes, who was one of Mark Zuckerberg's freshman year roommates at Harvard and later left the company in 2007, he published an op-ed in the Financial Times on Friday, which is stuck behind a paywall. But based on the quotes we've seen, he's not too positive about the whole Libra thing.
No, doesn't like it.
In tweets, he wrote, promoting his article, he wrote, what Libra backers are calling decentralization is in truth a shift of power away from developing world central banks and toward multinational corporations and the central banks of the largest economies. If Libra is successful, the problem will be bigger than more power for Facebook. We'll have to answer whether we want a global currency managed by a mostly for-profit private company or public ones. Basically, he's saying that rather than helping developing economies, Libra could end up disrupting them even more.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like, at the very least, this should be something that needs to be, like, hashed out in public with the governments of the
for
world.
For more than 6 months.
Yeah, like, it's...
So wait, you're gonna come in here, wreck our currency, and then hopefully everyone will just adopt yours?
Yeah, and there's a lot of arguments about, I mean... First of all, this is a libertarian's wet dream.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
They love it because of all the things it basically...
Well, if their currency's not working, they should use one centralized in our corporation.
It basically cripples the central banks of these countries. So, like, if they do go into economic depression or something, they don't really have a lot of power in, like, artificially bringing the economy back and using that to help get everything back on their feet because it won't be their actual money. But, yeah, I guess we'll see how it turns out.
It's
Move fast and break things.
6 months away. So.
Move fast and break the world economy.
Yeah. It's like a racehorse.
Yeah.
Move fast and break your legs.
Break your legs, then get shot in the face in
then
front
we'll
of
put you down,
20,000 people.
And as soon as we put down Libra, an entire country will disappear because they won't have an economy that's backed by anything.
But hey, they'll have Facebook.
Cool.
They're connected.
They got those Wi-Fi floaty balloons that are going to keep everyone connected.
Anyways, if all this tech news is making you a bit stressed out, it's time for a little sponsor break from this week's first sponsor, Calm. Did you know that a good night's sleep is like a magic remedy for the brain and the body?
And your horn.
Soon.
Yeah.
When we sleep well, we're more focused and relaxed. And best of all, sleep makes us happier. That's why we're happy to tell you about Calm, the number one app for sleep. Sleep deficiency does serious damage, not just to your brain, but to your body as well. The sleepless are more prone to accidents, weight gain, and depression. Mm-hmm. And sorry, folks, don't listen to the movies. You're not going to find love in Seattle.
No.
That only happens to Tom Hanks.
And when you're up on your phone reading it, growing a horn, you're not sleeping.
No.
So with Calm, you'll discover a whole library of programs designed to help you get the sleep that your brain and body needs, like soundscapes and over 100 sleep stories narrated by soothing voices like Jerome Flynn from Game of Thrones.
Oh, it's me, Bron.
And Stephen Fry. So if you want to seize the day, sleep the night, with the help of Calm, you can do it. And right now, our viewers can get 25% off a Calm premium subscription at calm.com, calm.com/tech, T-E-C-H. That's calm.com/tech. 40 million people have downloaded Calm, so find out why they've done that at calm.com/tech.
Calm.com. Mm-hmm. And this episode is also sponsored by Boosted Boards.
Wake up!
Wake up! You're well rested.
Time to get extreme.
And you've got places to go.
Yeah.
And you know time spent in traffic is time not spent exploring, creating, and having fun.
Or meditating.
True. Use Boosted to get where you need to be faster. Boosted's vehicle-grade electric skateboards and scooters are the modern solution to your transportation woes. With a 22-mile range and max speeds of 24 miles per hour, Boosted is perfect for going to the store or traveling across town.
Designed to provide a luxurious experience, it's no wonder that Boosted was one of Time Magazine's best inventions of 2018. With five options to pick from, including their new scooter, the Boosted Rev, there's a personal electric vehicle that's tailor-made for you. Now, starting at just $61 a month with financing, there's no better time to change how you move than now. Right now, Boosted is offering our viewers $75 off the purchase of an electric vehicle when you use the code NEWSDAY, all one word, at checkout. Go to boostedboards.com and use the promo code NEWSDAY at checkout to get $75 off your vehicle. That is boostedboards.com, promo code NEWSDAY at checkout for $75 off. They gave us one to test for a while, and I took it into work a couple of times, and I got here fast and cheap.
Gotta go fast.
Mm-hmm. But wear a helmet, because I did.
Please do, actually.
I'm an adult, and I wore a helmet, yeah. And I don't care if it looks silly, because I'm safe.
You should. In fact, just wear a helmet all the time.
Yeah, why not?
You know, like,
you know, if you hit that bone on the back of your head,
yeah.
They don't know what happens yet, but yeah. I bet that it's a very sensitive
point. That's just another point of failure in our already very delicate bone
Unless we
structure.
Grow a whole bunch of horns all over our heads that act like a helmet.
I'm going to be like the human version of a car from Mad Max. Just spikes and horns.
Just like
everywhere.
What's the guy that can survive a car crash from Australia?
Oh, Graham.
Graham. We'll look all like Graham.
I wonder how he's doing these days.
Probably living a wonderful
life. Keeps getting in car accidents. Like, man, it's a good thing I would look like this. It's a good thing I was designed to survive a car crash.
Yeah.
Anyways, back to the news now. Facebook is, as you know, terrible.
Mm-hmm.
But what if I told you that Facebook's not the only social media network being bad? In addition to deleting your Facebook account, you might want to also consider deleting your MySpace account.
Oh, where did I keep that thing?
Oh, wait. What year is it? It's 2019? You haven't, you literally weren't even born yet when it came, okay.
And they also accidentally deleted everything like a year ago because of a data transfer.
Yeah. Well, despite the fact that nobody uses MySpace anymore and most of its data from before 2017 got wiped out in a whoopsie, botched server migration, here's some MySpace news to make you feel all nostalgic.
Mm-hmm.
Turns out about 10 years ago, there was an internal tool at MySpace called Overlord, which, doesn't sound bad at all.
Good branding.
It was used. It was meant to be used for content moderation and for complying with law enforcement, like warrants and shit. But, you know, it also ended up just getting abused by various employees as a way to spy on people, including their ex-partners.
So Overlord allowed anyone using it to see people's passwords and their private communication. So, of course, it was abused by various people right around MySpace's peak as a social media network right before Facebook really took off after they tore down that wall and let people that didn't go to college in.
Yeah, I love the poorly educated.
It's kind of weird that people are blowing the whistle on this so long after it actually happened. Maybe they just feel safe, like,
you know, this has been sitting on my fucking shoulders for 10 years. Well, I need to let someone know.
I mean, even now, I don't know how much I can say about fucking Machinima, but
yeah,
I don't really. 10 years, you're like, who gives a shit?
Yeah.
Anyways, we'll have a lot to say about Machinima in 10 years. But anyways, back to this. It does, this whole MySpace being able to look at people's messages and passwords, it does show that there's always been a pattern for this kind of shadiness in social media. Facebook has, in more recent years, had to fire multiple employees over similar behavior. And just last month, it was reported that some Snapchat employees were also using an internal tool called SnapLion to spy on users and see their personal data. This is just kind of something that's always going to happen with these internet companies. And until there's more accountability, they're just going to keep dealing with it internally and finally only fessing up to it when journalists write about it and they're clear of all NDAs and the contracts they sign when they have to leave a company.
But hey, MySpace Tom, he got out at the right time, baby.
Dude, MySpace headquarters back in like 2008, just a huddled mass of people just jerking off people's DMs.
Yeah. Oh my God, yeah. People were very...
Was just listening to Hollywood Undead, just jerking off to people's DMs.
Facebook has never been as thirsty as MySpace was at its peak. It was a thirsty website.
Mm-hmm. Everyone, like, you go to a website, you hear their favorite song and see that animated GIF, Rose, Sparkly Rose.
Yeah.
The under construction sign.
Yeah.
Those were the days. Everyone learning, you know what, MySpace, they got everyone to learn HTML coding. If nothing else.
I mean, yeah, most of that coding is utterly worthless now. It was like HTML 2.
No.
What are we on, 5?
Do people code with it? I guess on WordPress sites. Well, oh well.
No, I mean, everything's built using templates and layers of shit, cascading style sheets, all that stuff. Just go to Squarespace. I don't have a promo code, but there's probably one.
Drag and drop tools. Enough.
Anyways, in other news, the city of San Francisco is about to ban e-cigarette sales.
What?
Which is a pretty big dick move when you consider that Juul is a San Francisco-based company. In fact, their offices are on city property. Anyway, the motivation behind the ban is that an alarming number of underage people, supposedly 20%, are somehow puffing on vapes despite it being illegal for them to do so.
My stars. I can't believe we survived 80 years of cigarette sales in the mass market without any kids smoking cigarettes.
I know. And these vapes come along, and now all these kids for the first time they're doing the nicotine. Oh my God. The move is also, it clearly seems to be a backhanded way of urging the FDA to start actually reviewing and approving vape products. I think they're basically trying to nudge Juul to be like, hey, Juul, demand that your shit get approved.
They do so much more than any other fucking cigarette company ever. It's crazy. They literally have to call me after I order a new Juul pod to confirm that I'm the one that ordered it at the address.
Well, yeah.
Anyway.
They're not doing nothing.
Yeah.
Last year, Juul voluntarily took all of its fruity flavors off store shelves following accusations that they're intentionally marketing to teens. Looks like their troubles are far from over, though.
Because teens love Virginia tobacco flavor.
I do appreciate... So, like, the regular pods, the 5%ers, are extremely strong.
Yeah.
Like, that is a fuck ton of nicotine. They started selling, like, 3%ers, like, 6 months ago. I'm like, that's good. But, like, if you're... Like, they always claim, they're like, oh, make the switch to Juul. Like, do it for your health. But I'm like, then why don't you sell fucking pods with no nicotine in them?
Yeah, just for... Well, I... listen... I'm not gonna act like I don't smoke the Juul.
I fucking smoke my Juul all goddamn day.
It's because in my late 20s, I became a fucking smoker because I'm a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
And I was an editor and everyone fucking smoked. And I have not had a cigarette in months, if not over a year, because of this thing.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it's probably a net positive.
Yes.
For a lot of people. But
I've already made the promise with the wife that if we ever have kids, I'll completely quit it.
Well,
everything.
Yeah. Because then you're getting that kid smoke. He'd go, I want to be like my dad.
You want some fruit flavor? No, I would never, ever do that. God, fuck off. Anyways, finally, the Raspberry Pi Foundation has released the fourth edition of their extremely tiny and extremely cheap computer that will almost certainly be used to play game ROMs.
Of course.
The Raspberry Pi 4 is 3 times as powerful as the third edition and around 40 times as powerful as the original 2012 Pi. And with this latest Pi, they're marketing it as a $35 desktop computer replacement with support for 2 4K monitors. Yeah, obviously this is a computer in the most basic sense, and you can't play the latest Steam games on one of these. But one of the most popular uses for the Pi has always been, as we said, retro gaming machine running emulators. There's also a ton of other DIY computing projects you can do with it. So for $35, the barrier for entry to this kind of thing, it's getting ridiculously low. They're very cool. They're especially cool if you want to have every game that you've ever owned as a child all in one place.
Well, they're literally the reason why all of these game companies were like, fuck, we need to make tiny retro mini consoles before the people catch on that they can probably do this themselves for half the price.
Yeah.
But it's pretty crazy. $35 for a computer.
A computer that you can learn to code on.
Yeah, learn to code.
Mm-hmm. Anyways, that's it for this week's episode of Tech Newsday. Please check out our sponsors if you're in the market for either of those. And we're posting a new exclusive podcast today where I'm going to show Elliot the most ridiculous video I've ever seen all week.
Oh.
So get excited for that.
All week?
It's, I mean, every week on the internet is like a year in real life, so it's a pretty big moment.
It's true.
So if you want to see, listen to that exclusive podcast, you have to be a member of our Patreon or a member on YouTube. You can click the join button below the YouTube video and check the community tab for that, or head over to Patreon and check the posts if you're a member, and you'll see that exclusive podcast. Other than that, check out our two most recent episodes, including a brand new episode of Weekly Weird News and a news dump, and we'll see you guys next time.
Bye.